Hey everybody, and welcome to my WWE Survivor Series 2015 pay-per-view review. Thanks for joining me here for this pay-per-view review, and oh boy, do we have quite a bit to discuss coming out of this night. An interesting night, to say the very least. Whether you loved it, hated it, whatever, we'll get there. Either way, thanks for watching, and I will be doing my Q&A video this coming week. Just wanted to let you guys know, all set with questions, got more than enough, and I'll be recording it probably tomorrow night and then uploading it, but I will not be reviewing Raw this week. Just want to let you guys know that right off the bat, so you have an idea of what to expect. So just the Q&A coming up this week, and then I'm not going to be uploading again until sometime during the week next week. So anyway, let's go ahead and get into Survivor Series here tonight. Now, first and foremost, I'm really glad that the event went well and that there was no security issues or anything like that because of all this, ISIS talk and what's going on with all that stuff. I'm just really glad that we got through this pay-per-view without any BS going on, because it really did make me nervous when I heard about all this stuff a couple of days ago. Anyway, first of all, we had the first two matches of the night go toward the semifinals in the WWE Championship Tournament. So we got Roman Reigns, Del Rio, Alberto Del Rio, and then Dean Ambrose and Kevin Owens. So kind of just going to talk about these in conjunction to conserve some time. Roman Reigns and Del Rio. This was a decent match that was overridden by the fact that it was really obvious that Roman Reigns is going to win. I had no reason to believe that Alberto Del Rio could win this match, mainly because of the fact that I look at the two characters and it's like it's very obvious that Roman Reigns will move on here. This was a good, solid match, though. There was some nice spots throughout, and the wrestling in the ring was not too bad. It just was not easy to sit there and be like, oh, I'm into this, because you're not sure who's going to go to the finals. You were just about 100% sure it was going to be Roman Reigns in this particular situation. Again, a solid in-ring match, but overridden by the fact that it felt too easy for Roman Reigns to win. I didn't feel like Alberto Del Rio was a legit threat, even though the match told a story which said Del Rio was. Some good near falls. I liked the way that Del Rio used the cross arm breaker and almost hit his finisher off the top as well. And, a couple of good near falls on both ends, like I said. So that one gets like a 2.5 out of 5 for me, just a, in the middle type of rating. And then for Ambrose and Kevin Owens, I thought this match was a whole hell of a lot better. It really was. And mainly to me because of the fact that you weren't 100% sure who was going to win this. I mean, you had a good idea it was probably going to be Dean Ambrose, but you couldn't be 100% on that because Kevin Owens winning was not an unrealistic option here. So this was a better match, I think, top to bottom anyway. Obviously, the lack of predictability was nice, but also the quality of the match was certainly stepped up. I think it was well-booked top to bottom. You had Kevin Owens being a great and impressive heel as usual, doing a lot of trash-talking, slowing the pace down. Ambrose winning clean off of Dirty Deeds, which I think was really important here as well. A couple of really nice transitions throughout the match, some good reversals, counters, near falls, good stuff throughout. Like I said, Kevin Owens controlling the pace early on, being the methodical heel that he is, plays so effectively. Ambrose doing a great job on the babyface end of things, making that comeback, avoiding the pop-up powerbomb toward the end. So definitely was a good, solid match to follow up what was a decent opener, but this was probably one of my favorites as far as in-ring action goes. So I would give this one 3.5 stars out of 5. So definitely better than the first match. And then by the end of this, it's Reigns and Ambrose in the finals. That will be the final match of the night. So overall, decent stuff. Like I said, first match, predictable. Wrestling wasn't quite as good. And then the second one, better action, better chemistry. And honestly, I don't mind the idea of Ambrose versus Owens for the Intercontinental Championship going forward, because I think these two together have very good in-ring chemistry. So then we get a thrown together, out of the blue, traditional Survivor Series match, which is Ryback, the Usos, and the Lucha Dragons against the New Day, the three members of the New Day, Sheamus and King Barrett. Before the match, we get a fun and enjoyable promo from the New Day, and Sheamus, of course, ruins the vibe there. A little bit of a prelude to what we would get a little later on. Ryback, the Usos, and Lucha Dragons end up winning. I think it was Sin Cara and one of the Usos who got eliminated in this match. But other than that, Ryback, the other Uso, and Kalisto all finished as survivors in winning this match. The New Day, once Big E was eliminated, the other two members, Xavier Woods and Kofi Kingston, went with him, so they eliminated themselves pretty much. Barrett was the first person gone, and Sheamus was the last person gone. This was very thrown together. The in-ring action, there wasn't a whole lot to take away from it. It wasn't terrible, but it also would just felt like a match that you would have seen on Raw. Really, it did. And there was nothing on the line. And that's the biggest problem with this. It's like, you know, traditional Survivor Series matches are supposed to be 5-on-5 eliminations, but they also have something on the line. There's got to be some reason to have this 5-on-5 match. You know, they had one in the pre-show as well. Same type of deal. You know, what the fuck is on the line here? Like, you know, last year you had the authorities' jobs on the line. Something. I would have much rather just seen the Usos versus the New Day for the tag titles if that's really what this was supposed to accomplish. So this didn't do much of anything for me. I didn't feel like there was any real rivalry. I know they've had the Usos and Ryback team against the New Day in the past. I know that Lucha Dragons even faced Sheamus and Barrett at one point as well. So I'm not saying that this match made zero sense whatsoever. It's not that they haven't faced each other or any of that stuff. But there isn't really big-time rivalries going on. You're basically just mushing a bunch of shit together and just saying, yeah, here you go. Because, oh, wait, we need a traditional Survivor Series match to actually make this feel like a Survivor Series pay-per-view. But instead of it being effective or there being a whole lot on the line or this being an embroiled or hot feud, there wasn't any of that. And so it just felt completely manufactured, thrown together at the last moment, and that's what killed this match. So this one gets just a 2 out of 5 for me. And honestly, the 2 out of 5 comes mainly from the New Day being entertaining and the fact that the match quality wasn't terrible. It just was nothing special about it. But it wasn't complete trash, just wasn't very good. Anyway, let's move on to the Divas Championship. Charlotte retains over Paige. Now, I know there's a lot of controversy with this whole thing going dating back to Raw this past Monday and everything with the whole mentioning of Charlotte's brother Reed. And then the family came out that the family hadn't even approved of this whole thing, which is a complete mess because that therefore makes this a really terrible segment from Raw on WWE's part for not even considering the Flair family first and foremost. So I think with all that coming out, it was pretty clear Charlotte was going to retain here, and she did via submission with the figure eight. It was an okay match. I don't feel like the story they were trying to tell us on Raw with this long-term friendship that has led to all this stuff and all the animosity that's between them and all the aggression Charlotte should be feeling was translated as effectively as it could have been here. And not only that, but I just felt that the match kind of dragged along and I wasn't into it. I couldn't get myself emotionally invested into this match. And yes, it does have something to do with the build-up. Yes, it does have something to do with the fact that in one episode of Raw, we were suddenly supposed to go from feeling like whatever about this to trying to be like, yeah, gung-ho. Like, oh, this is a long-time feud, of course. Like, let's just erase the other weeks of stuff that had nothing to do with this. But anyway, the match was just okay. It was blah. There was nothing that really stood out about this that made me say, wow, great Divas title match. And they got like 14 minutes too. And I still, like, I'm looking for highlights in my head and I'm like, man, I don't even remember a whole lot of this match because it was just one of those contests where you kind of just watched it. It went by you and you're like, yep, that was whatever. It was what you expect Divas matches on pay-per-views to be. And that's too bad because these are two much more talented Divas than from years past, and they could put out a great storyline with them. But instead, Charlotte's robotic, and she's not even half of what she used to be on NXT. Paige is playing the heel role very well. She's doing a good job with this, but I still just find myself not really caring very much, and this match just kind of helped to underline that. It was kind of slow. It was just, it wasn't the best match those two have put on, and I don't know. It just really was hard to reach for me on an emotional level. So Charlotte retains. Yeah, whatever. The tap out spot even at the end was kind of weak too. This gets 1.5 out of 5 for me. Let's move on to Tyler Breeze and defeating Dolph Ziggler in a singles action. This was just an all right match. It felt like just another Raw match or just a regular old run of the mill type of one. And that's too bad because I think Tyler Breeze and Dolph Ziggler actually have something. Like that could actually be a really good and compelling type of feud. But instead of it being good, compelling, or anything like that, we get pretty much just a random mid-card match at a pay-per-view. Which is too bad because this one's going to get lost in the shuffle. And this isn't the type of match that you're going to sit there and watch a second time. It just didn't have that appeal to it. And that has a lot to do with the fact that you started to build this feud and then did nothing with it for the last couple of weeks. That's what happens. People forget the match is even going to be there, never mind are actually going to be into it. They're going to go get a snack at the concession stand. They're not going to sit there and watch this match. That isn't what's going to keep their asses in the seats. Tyler Breeze going over is the biggest highlight of this. It was an okay match. Again, decent match. Some good spots. I like the pacing of this. I like the quickness. I think that these two can put on much better matches. I think they deserve to have a feud that actually is centered around them and could actually help build their characters in some way, shape, or form. I think this match exemplified and showed me that Dolph Ziggler's character is really just in a terrible position. But I will say Tyler Breeze winning is great. The commentary team tried to sell this as some huge win for Tyler Breeze as if this is going to, you know, oh my god, this could catapult his career. Not exactly. Not exactly at all. Because Dolph Ziggler's being a little bit irrelevant lately. But now, the other thing I do take away from this, too, is that Tyler Breeze did win this match cleanly, which is a really nice thing as well. So, I like Breeze. I like the way he, carries himself. I like the character. But overall, this is just going to get 2.5 stars out of 5 for me. Just kind of falls into the middle because, again, it's one of those situations where you're like, yeah, you know, it was all right, but it could have been a lot better. And I think that's really the disappointing factor about that. So then Undertaker and Kane defeat the Wyatts. Are you surprised? I mean, I know I'm not. I knew the Wyatt family wasn't going to win this match, but I did come into it saying that the Wyatts really needed this win because this is almost like strike three because you look back, WrestleMania 30, Wyatt lost to John Cena. Earlier this year, WrestleMania 31, you have Wyatt lose to Undertaker, and now here at Survivor Series 2015, losing to Taker and Kane in a tag match. I think that is like strike three. You know, I don't take the Wyatt family seriously anymore. I can't. Because they have all these, it's the same old shit. You know, they attack, explain the actions, and then lose the feud. It's like, how am I supposed to take this cult, this group, this idea of a leader seriously? As a fan, how do I take that seriously if they don't win any of their matches? If they don't ever live up to the words that they say? You know what I mean? Mainly, it's just only Bray Wyatt who talks. But you get my drift. Like, this group is built and given to you as such, but yet they never win. And if they never win, then why would you take it seriously? Why would you sit there and say to yourself, you know what? The Wyatts are a fucking, they're going to kick everyone's ass. Like, why would you think that they're going to kick anybody's ass? Or why would you think that they actually are going to make any type of a difference or have any type of impact on anything if they can't even win in a two-on-two situation? So, again, what I did like about the match was the way that they had Undertaker's entrance set up. That was fucking awesome. All the iterations of Undertaker's look over the years being up there as well was freaking awesome, too. And then on top of that, to have basically the whole match be like a tribute to Undertaker and King, like them doing their big spots, doing their big moments throughout the match. And it is a shame that the Wyatt family basically had to be that whipping boy, so to speak. They had to be the ones who take the fall, but they just like there was a nice positive in that manner. But the in-ring match itself was okay. It was just all right. It's gonna get right in that 2.5 range, but what will bump it up for me ultimately to a 3 out of 5 is the fact that you had so much dedication to The Undertaker. You made it feel like it was a special moment and night for The Undertaker and for Kane as the Brothers of Destruction, which I thought was really cool. I wouldn't have minded Kane chokeslamming him or something like that by the end just to build up to WrestleMania between the two if that's the direction they're going in. I don't know if that is the direction they're going in or if this was the actual finale for Undertaker. I think he will finish at WrestleMania 32 for real. But this was an awesome moment in that way. So there were some cool things about this, but the match itself was whatever. And then on top of that, you have the Wyatt family losing again. Braun Strowman being a guy who, you know, got brought up and you're like, yes, this guy could be something. And he gets, you know, just double chokeslammed through a table. Like, it's hard because Bray Wyatt has some really intimidating looking guys. When you have Eric Rowan, Luke Harper, and Braun Strowman following you around, you're an imposing looking group. But when, you know, your guys can't ever win matches and you can't ever win matches, it's like actions and words, you know. Actions always speak louder than words. That's what we all say, right? Well, if actions speak louder than words, then your words are doing a great fucking job, but those actions tell me that you're a loser. So the words that you say, I'm not going to believe very much anymore if you can't even go out there and win matches. And that's the thing, you know. So he loses all these big major feuds, and that's the thing. You're losing big four matches, and more importantly, you're losing major feuds, which are extremely important in the development of a character long term. So definitely very disappointing and definitely a bad moment for the Wyatts, and it's going to take me a long-ass time before I'm going to sit there and say I believe in the Wyatts as a legit threat again. I certainly don't anytime soon. But the Brothers of Destruction winning, again, not all bad because there was, you know, cool video packages, you know, leading into this, as well as the way that the entrance was constructed and everything like that. So there was, again, some good stuff in there. It bumps it to a 3 out of 5, but the in-ring stuff was just, you know, run of the mill. Nothing crazy that stuck out. Okay, then let's get to our finale. The WWE Championship finale. Roman Reigns and Dean Ambrose, and Roman Reigns walks away with the victory via spear in only 12 minutes. Now, so this match for me was actually really going well, but the problem is the abrupt finish prevented it from being a match that could have reached that upper echelon of being very good. You know, instead of it being you know, very good, it ends up being just okay. And that's too bad, because if this got more time dedicated to it, it really could have been a great match. Because I think that what we did get was very good. I liked that there was a start of a lot of respect and then kind of a shoving match, you know, and then leading to punches back and forth. And I liked the dynamic they were telling me. I liked the story they were telling me. I loved when Ambrose hit the dirty deeds and Reigns kicked out. I liked that Reigns hit the Superman punch and Ambrose kicked out. They made it look like these two guys were tit for tat, pretty even. And then the spear comes a little bit too fucking early and Ambrose doesn't kick out. And you're like, oh God, it's not even 20 of 11 yet. So you know that some shit's gonna go down. The confetti's coming down, all this other shit. And Triple H comes out to congratulate Reigns. And then shortly thereafter, Sheamus ends up cashing in his Money in the Bank contract and winning the championship off of a second bro kick because Reigns kicked out of the first. But mind you, before that, Roman Reigns speared Triple H in the middle of the ring, which was an awesome moment and should have been the way that this pay-per-view ended. So, again, for the match itself of Reigns and Ambrose, I give that 2.75 out of 5. Now, the reason why that falls so low is because of how quickly and rushed the finish was executed or was not executed. It just really hurt what otherwise was a pretty damn good match. That was on the verge of being at least a 3.5, maybe close to a 4-star match because of the fact that it was going so well. If you slap on an extra 7-8 minutes on that match, it's probably like a 4-star match. It was actually going quite well. But that abrupt finish really did a number on it to hurt it. And then what we end up getting after that is just the worst thing possible. Again, I talked in the predictions video as well as in my PWF Empire predictions about the possibility of Sheamus winning. Again, I said Reigns would ultimately walk away with the championship. But the other possibility is that Sheamus walks away with the title too. And those are the two things that I see happening most. And they did do the Sheamus winning the championship thing. And that just sucks. A lot of people were throwing stuff, going crazy, getting all upset, and canceling their network and whatever. You know, I think that's all well, fine, and good, but I did not get that upset. I am not that upset. to this very moment. The reason why I didn't get that upset is because I expected this. Like, people are acting like they're shocked that Sheamus could cash in, and how dare them do this? Fuck this company, this, that, the other. Like, did you actually believe this company was going to do something different? I mean, in my mind's eye, the two possibilities was either Reigns is going to win the belt and walk out clean, or second, Reigns is going to win the belt, and then Sheamus is going to cash in on a weak Roman Reigns and win the championship. It's either one or the other. Those were the two things. My bold prediction was that Dean Ambrose would turn heel. I could have seen either guy turning heel, but it was either going to be Reigns winning or Sheamus cashing in and winning. And that's, to me, seemed like the most realistic possibility. So I was not only not surprised, but I just kind of sat there and was like, yep, here we go. It wasn't one of those things where I'm like, no, oh my God, no. It just, like, I felt it, you know? And this just further underlines the lack of interest in the product for a lot of people. People aren't going to sit there and be like, yo, you know what, that was an awesome moment. Can't wait to see Sheamus with the belt. People are going to be like, Sheamus is ready for the championship? Hell fucking no, is he ready for the championship. It's not even a question if he's ready or not. He isn't even close to the level of the world title. So for him to win it here was just really crappy. If he was at least built up better to be ready for the championship, I think the amount of problems that I personally would have with it would be a whole hell of a lot less. Again, you have an opportunity here if you're WWE to do a whole lot of different things. You can have a heel turn, you could have, you know, whatever you want. You could have Reigns win clean, Triple H try to come out and congratulate him, and he spears him, and that's the end of the night. Reigns holds up the belt with a Triple H down in the ring. That's a pretty damn cool way to finish it. Then Triple H could kick off the next night on Raw and tell Reigns that he has to defend his championship tonight against, you know, whomever. It could be against Sheamus, you know. Again, you could really mix things up. And they didn't mix things up. They gave you as much of a cliche, as much of a predictable finish as you could possibly imagine right now. Because again, we're now used to the fuckery so much that it happens all the time, and we aren't surprised when it happens. In fact, we are more surprised when it doesn't happen anymore. I would have been more surprised if Reigns just won the championship clean and that was the end of the night, rather than him, you know, getting screwed over like that. I am not surprised. I'm not pissed. I'm not throwing stuff, because I'm just like, yep, here we go. Again, status quo, same old, same old. And I think that's one of the things WWE needs to work on, is just getting away from this status quo, same old shit, cliche, we're ready for the same shit all the time type of deal. I think that we are at a point in time right now where different and new things are constantly going to need to be in effect because of the way that, you know, the audience is right now. You can't have the same exact shit all the time and expect people to always just enjoy it. Me myself as a longtime fan, I sit there and I'm like, I can't see the same shit over and over again, and be expected to, you know, continue to praise a company for doing the same shit. What is with the knee-jerk reaction? That's my biggest question. What is with this, like, necessity to, oh my God, we have to make sure that something cool happens in Survivor Series now that Rollins is injured. Oh yeah, Sheamus cash in. Like, why? Why can't they just have a tournament match and go with it from there? But they didn't. They didn't do that. They didn't go that route. They ended up giving you probably the worst possibility, and that's Sheamus cashing in and winning. So Sheamus is your world champion to finish the night, and a lot of people are pissed off. And I'm certainly not one of the people who is that pissed off at all. I'm not fuming or anything like that. You can tell I'm quite calm. It did not get under my skin. It did not piss me off to that level, because the main reason why it didn't is because I just could see it coming from a mile away. And when you see something coming, you just shake your head or nod your head. You don't sit there and you scream at the TV. There's no need to, because you figured that was one of the main possibilities of what could happen here. So overall, Survivor Series is going to get a 4.75 out of 10 for me. I know that's an awfully low rating, and I don't usually hand out lower ratings like that, but this one was below average. This is a Big Four pay-per-view, and I could probably give this show an even lower rating, to be completely honest. But I did find some positives in it. However, it was an underwhelming show, primarily for a Big Four, but just in general was an underwhelming show. The semifinal matches for the tournament were decent, especially Ambrose and Owens was actually quite good. The traditional Survivor Series match was thrown in there, random crap. The Divas title match was underwhelming as well, hard to get into. Tyler Breeze and Dolph Ziggler is a really good match, but it felt like something from Raw rather than an actual pay-per-view match because there was no reason to be into it, again, because the feud was not consistently built. The Brothers of Destruction, the Wyatts, this is a terrible moment for the Wyatts and not only continues to further prove that they aren't a legit faction after all. It was a really nice tribute to Undertaker, both through the entrance and the match itself. Both felt like a really nice tribute to him and a fitting one at that. So it wasn't completely unentertaining and it wasn't completely shitty. It definitely had some good moments and it was actually worth giving 3 stars because of all that. The Wyatt family, though, it felt like Rock and Cena versus the Awesome Truth from like a few years back. You know it's a one-sided game here. The Brothers of Destruction are destined to win this thing. So, not surprised, but again, the Wyatts are just going down the shitters once more. And then, of course, the championship final match actually was going really well, but ended way too abruptly. And then the fucking cash-in to finish the night, which is just the worst option WWE could have gone with. The worst decision they really could have made. I feel like it was knee-jerk. If we had Rollins and we had Reigns one-on-one, you would have had Reigns win the belt clean, and that would have been the end of the night. There would have been the confetti, and that would have been that. I don't think Sheamus cashes in if it was Reigns versus Rollins. I really don't. I think this plan came into fruition a whole hell of a lot more so because of the fact that Rollins was injured, you know? It's one of those situations where you know, you have two guys, Ambrose and Roman Reigns, who are very good talents, but the problem is, it's a lateral match. You know, neither guy is this, like, huge star where, like, something's crazy on the line. Like, this didn't have a big impact feel when Roman Reigns won the championship. And then not only that, but because of the fact that it was rushed enough, you knew that there was enough time for something strange to take place to finish the night off, and that is just exactly what we got, and there you have it. There you have it with Survivor Series 2015. Not exactly the brightest note to finish off the night, but overall, a show that had a few positives in there, but honestly was below average, and so therefore is going to get under a 5 out of 10 for me, and then this way to finish the night is just there's really nothing else to say but disappointing and definitely not a show that I felt was a strong one. So let me know what you guys thought down below, of course. Be sure to give me a like if you enjoyed. And give me your thoughts on Survivor Series and subscribe for plenty more to come. And I will be doing my Q&A during the week, so look forward to uploading that one for you guys. Thanks as always for watching. Really appreciate you guys taking the time, and can't wait to see you for the Q&A, and then, yeah, I will be, you know, taking the week away, but after that, I'll be back, regular upload schedule. So, until next time, peace out.